need to open this first. Some of you I've met before. Some of you I have not been fortunate enough to meet. My name's Jason. How you doing? See, it looks like a beer too. I'm a Windows MVP for PowerShell. Windows PowerShell MVP, whatever they do that with. The VP and CFO for PowerShell.org. We run the summits and things like that. It would help if I just drank stuff. And I'm also a full-time author at Pluralsight. Come watch our videos.
I do. It's a
great site.
Yeah. Okay. I want to talk to you about something. I want to give you a couple of, I want to give you a demonstration. It's not about the code. It's about the demonstration. And I want to see if I can convey a concept to you. How many of you currently work, and you are only going to know this if it's in your job description or title, in DevOps? No time. Okay, but at least you have some concept of what continuous delivery is.
They keep trying to call us DevOps. We haven't been officially called DevOps.
Oh, okay, then you suck.
I'm no longer with you.
I don't want you to think about the marketing term DevOps, whether you know what it is or not, what continuous delivery is, although there's a great book on continuous delivery, also a great book called The Phoenix Project that will make you want to read the book on continuous delivery. I'm not here to sell you on that. I'm here to just give you what I deal with on large-scale customers every day. So I want you to get the concept. Don't worry about the freaking code. I'll give you resources for that later. Yeah? Okay. Now, first of all, we got to get a couple of things straight. Maybe, maybe not. Are you laughing at this? How can you laugh at this? This is... Okay, how many of you in this room are too young to know what the hell this is? This is the greatest series of Star Trek ever done. The Next Generation. Okay, so, if you've ever seen this series, here's what you know for a fact. You've got Jean-Luc Picard. Number one. Better to be number one than number two. Here's what would happen. The Enterprise would be flying into some situation. Every episode, they're going into some situation. Everybody's going to die. The ship's going to blow up. The planet's going to blow up. The time warp's going to happen. Who knows? Brothers and sisters, cats and dogs. Something's going to be totally wrong. And all of a sudden, in the last 10 minutes of the episode, Jean-Luc Picard will stand up. Knowing what the answer to the problem is. And he will say, number one, make it so. And number one's over here going, what the... Data, go play with the computers. Jordy, go realign something. Deanna, you just stand there and look good, baby. I want you to think about what just happened. He's the guy doing the work. I got to get Jordy to realign something. Do this, do this, do this. He's instructing people and things on how to do things. What's he doing? He solved the problem, then told the doers, go do that. He solved the business problem. These are just the guys going like this, little monkeys. I need you to think about something. And this stresses me out too. This is what we are. We are the doers. And you know this. You need to set up a SQL server. If you're a SQL server person, you know the steps to do that. I need to do this, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. I need to set up an Exchange server. That means I need to do this, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. Why do you need an Exchange server? Well, somebody up at management level said we needed this thing called email, and I'm just, yeah. Somebody else decided what the solution was. You're just the implementer. I want to ask you guys a question. Have you ever seen this t-shirt that's a joke that says, don't piss me off or I'll replace you with a script. How many of you own it? How many of you have really thought that through? Because guess what we've done? Everything you know how to do has been automated. Because you're not the only one who knows how to do it. And here's what is the cool part. By the way, that doesn't mean you're out of a job. Because here's what I've always wanted to do since being a small, wee child. Well, no, actually, I think I was in college but when the series was out, but at any rate. I've never wanted to be him. Looky here. I've always wanted to be him. Now I am. Now, I decide what the solution to the business problem is, and I tell the computer, make it so. I want you to notice something in what I just said. I tell the computer to make it so. Guess who I'm not telling to make it so? Because I don't need them. These people I don't need. You know who I need a lot of? People that know how to solve the problem and know how to ask the computer to make it so. So if you're looking for what your next career is going to be, I'm going to show it to you. You're going to like this. Well, let me put it this way. It doesn't matter whether you like it. We're in IT. You're the one that wanted the $100,000 job. Guess what? Sometimes it sucks. And here's the other thing. You don't have to like it. It's like gravity, man. I don't like gravity. Doesn't matter. It's still here. How many of you like the vision that Microsoft has of NanoServer? Don't put your hand in here. You do. Okay. But you're young. You're dumb. No. How many of you think Microsoft's making a huge mistake with that? No graphical desktop, NanoServer, small, tight, secure. Oh, come on. We see you on Twitter. We know you're there. A lot of people disagree. You know what? You might disagree with Microsoft's vision on anything. And here's the deal. You might be right. They might be full of crap. But it doesn't matter. It's gravity. What I'm about to show you is a Microsoft side to DevOps. Brief demonstration of it. You don't have to like it, but this is what it is. This is what your companies are doing, whether you know it or not. I've got a couple of stories. One of them is about that. You may not know it. Now, I also want to say this. Microsoft, and this might be uncomfortable for some people in the room, I am obviously not somebody who drinks from the company store. Actually, I am. But those of us on the enterprise side, have you ever heard Jeffrey Snover say, it's all about crossing over? Jeffrey Snover has an iPhone. Because he likes the iPhone. And there's nothing wrong with that. You guys know that Azure has Linux, right? Have you guys been to the PowerShell.org website? I had a guy come up to me the other day, well actually this is a while ago, yelling at me, going, how dare you have a PHP website for PowerShell.org? I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, it should have been written in .NET. Well, it's a puny website with some forums on it. We don't need .NET. We just needed PHP, so I wrote in PHP, like 80% of the rest of the world. No, and I said, well, not, now I'm really going to upset you, because it's PHP, but it's running on Apache. He goes, but you're the IIS guy. Somebody told me I'm an IIS guy. Sorry, I just threw that out, but I'm embarrassed. But I am an IIS guy. And he says, you're the IIS guy. How can you put it on Apache? I said, this is really going to, I said, piss you off, but this is really going to, not only is it a PHP site running on Apache, it's running in Azure on Linux. You just hear his brain short. This is the world we live in. Whatever the customer has, we deal with. Here's what the customer has. They have a business problem. They need to move faster, be more agile, and I know you've heard that 1,000 times. Windows finally got the tools. Linux has had this for a long time. This is why we like Linux guys, because they get this. You guys can get this. You guys get automation and PowerShell. You're already way ahead of the game. So this is what we need today. Now, I want to give you just a couple of pointers, and I'm going to start a demonstration. I want you to think about Jean-Luc Picard saying, number one, make it so. Do you ever think number one's going to turn around and go, you know what, shut it? You know, not unless he's, you know, but, you know, think of this as, you know, like any other naval ship. When the captain says something, anybody here from the Navy? When the captain says to do something, what's the answer?
Yes, sir.
And if you don't want to do it, what's the answer?
Yes, sir.
There you go. And if you decide that you and your buddies don't want to do it, what's the answer?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. You better believe it. I want you to think about something. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to decide what the solution is going to be. From a code perspective, it's really easy for me to write this up. It's called a configuration. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that configuration. That configuration, by the way, has no intelligence in it. Because that configuration asks resources that are already built in to go out and do the things that need to be done. Let me give you an example. I don't know how to install a SQL. I do, but just play with me. I don't know how to install a SQL server, but I can write a config that will then call up a resource that will install and configure a SQL server. I just know I need one. Get it? How many of you are experts at large-scale enterprise exchange implementations? Well, if you do what I show you, you will be. Because I can build an exchange environment over and over and over again, every single hour, at extreme large scale, sending updates, changes, whatever I want, every hour. How often do you guys send updates to your servers? Don't embarrass me and say, updates? I can send them every hour. You need to do this. Have you looked at what's happening to our security? So, this, I can make it so, but here's the best part. When something goes wrong at your office, what's, you know, something, you know, a server array, you know, you've got like a load balancer with all these servers in it, just blows up, nothing's working. What's the first words out of your mouth? What's the first thing you say when something blows up and goes wrong?
What changed?
What changed? Why are you saying that? Because, hopefully this will re-engage.
Make it so.
Make sure I come over here and rub this every now and again. Why do you say what's changed?
Does it work before? It
worked yesterday.
You know, computers, if you keep your damn hands off them, what do they keep doing? We know this. Hardware, software. It's rare that something that's just running fails. So you've learned from the very first days in IT, when something goes wrong, somebody touched something that screwed it up. So now you've got to go figure it out, find it, and all this. Here's the cool part. When I say, make it so to a system, that's the way it's going to be. I'm going to show you this. If you walk up to the system and say, oh, who put this web server here? Let's just remove that. Computer says no. In other words, it's not what you desire. It's what I desire. So I'm going to show you desired state configuration, DSC. I am not taking you soup to nuts through DSC. I'm just doing a quick demo of what the expected results are. If you want soup to nuts, there are materials out there. However, just to throw this out there, not to be a jerk, next week I'm going to be a tech mentor where I'm doing multiple sessions on soup to nuts with DSC, from the very beginning to expert level troubleshooting. They still have tickets, because if you want to come to the really cool one, which is the PowerShell Summit, we're sold out. That's where Steve Morosky and I are doing soup to nuts on DSC. But there's other resources out there for it too. You want to start doing this. I guarantee those people that are going to be at the summit, that are going to be at the pre-con, the next day, they're going to start changing their infrastructure. We call this infrastructure from code. You'll hear people say infrastructure as code. That's like a butchering of the English language. Your infrastructure isn't code. Your infrastructure are real things, machines, servers, applications, Exchange, SQL, DHCP, Active Directory. All of that can be built from code. That can be built over and over and over again. I'm going to start a demonstration because it takes a while to run, and I'm going to give you a couple of quick stories.
First of all, if you're interested, at the end of this, I'll be happy to show you my configuration. But what I've done is I've written a very simple DSC configure. I just lied to you. I'm sorry. I tried not to do that. But it actually is. It's really simple. You could look at it and completely understand it. Now, I went a little nuts in here because this is actually one that I use in the real world. Because here's what I like. When I set something up, I like to decide what's allowed to be set up on this box and what's not allowed to be set up on this box. Because one of the things that people do, oh yeah, he's got this under DSC configuration, so we can't touch that. But I can go over here and screw with this. That might break my stuff. So I say, here's what I want. Here's what I don't want. So in my script, it's a little bit longer than needs be because I'm a little over anal. Now I'm going to start this. And here's how DSC in general works for an architecture. I want you to notice this is a PS1. You write this in PowerShell. It's easy. However, when you run it, PowerShell isn't understood by the target nodes. And I want you to get used to saying nodes. Say nodes.
Nodes.
Here's why PowerShell isn't understood by the target nodes and why we use the word nodes. Notice I'm not using the word computer name. Because it may not be a Windows box. Because here's what I can do with that. I can configure a Windows box, a Linux box. I can configure a Cisco switch. It doesn't matter. So let that sink in for a minute. Do you get the idea? So they're nodes. They're just cattle. And I'm going to get to my pets versus cattle thing in a minute. Now, here's the deal. I want you to notice the files that were created. I specifically had two nodes that I have VMs for that these files are created. They're called MOFs. How many of you work with SCCM? So you've seen a MOF before. Here's what a MOF is. It's the only thing that's not Microsoft proprietary. Think that through. If I want to manage systems from around the world, whether they be Linux, switches, routers, Windows, Microsoft had to choose a format that everybody understands. They couldn't create a proprietary one, so here's what they did. They used the one that everybody else uses. Now, if you don't think that's weird, remember, Microsoft, the Borg, right? This isn't the Borg anymore. So this is a format, it's a text file. You can look at it, don't bother. Because you don't need to read it. Don't touch it, for the love of God, because it's very picky, and you'll break it. You write beautiful PowerShell, it makes it for you automatically. But here's the deal. We now need to get that MOF to the target nodes. Two ways to do it. In a test or a development environment, I will push it. I will do something, I will just push it. Basically, copy the file. In a real environment, I will have a pull server that the nodes will pull this from. It's a web server. Very easy setup. It's just a dumb web server, free. And you can pull from it. One web server can run a huge company. Because of tiny files. Here's what I need you to understand. Where is this file going? I don't know if you noticed this, but Microsoft slipped something into your operating system when you weren't watching. It's something called the LCM, the Local Configuration Manager. It's this little dude that sits here, runs at kernel, and sits here and goes, if I have a configuration, I'm going to configure this box. And I'm going to make sure it stays that way. If I don't have a configuration, you never know I was there. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to send that configuration to the two target nodes and let the LCMs go, I got a config. I'll configure the box.
And while this is running, it's going to take a couple of minutes for this to run. I think about three. Let me tell you what this is actually configuring. And I'll bring it bigger up on a screen.
This is verbose output. This normally runs as a background job, so you wouldn't see this, but I'm telling it to show it on the screen, and this isn't going to make any sense, and that's okay. As soon as you start working with it, this all makes sense. Basically, blue is good. Anything else, not good. You'll see a couple of amber lines. Those are okay, too, but yeah. Here's what's happening. I have a config. I have two servers that have their default installed. By the way, all my servers are always core. My customers use core. I use core. I haven't seen a graphical server in years. Two core boxes, default install. One of them is going to become a web server with an open, an HTTP website, including all the website files for that application. The other one's going to become a web server with a secured website with a very specific configuration, in a very challenging application. So I'll have an open one and a secured one. Are you with me? Now here's what I want you to think about. If anything happens to those boxes, what do you think I'm going to do to fix that problem? Send that configuration to where? Pets versus cattle. You need to start thinking about your servers, not as pets, as cattle. This is a DevOps term. A lot of people treat their servers like Fluffy. Oh, I love Fluffy. Fluffy, I care so much about Fluffy. If Fluffy's not feeling good, I will spend thousands of dollars and weeks of time at the doctor taking care of Fluffy. I love Fluffy. Nothing can happen to Fluffy. Treat your servers like cattle. Cow gets sick, bang, put it on a barbecue, new cow. Think that through. I'm going to give you a real world example here in a minute. I was doing something for a very large video producing company. Name shall not be mentioned. Working with their IT department on PowerShell workflow stuff. And so while Don and I were standing there, they had an emergency. Phone goes off of the lead guy, followed by the other guys. Message comes up. They've lost the entire ability to play video worldwide. Would you say that's a problem? Here's what the response was from the open source Linux guy using Windows boxes. Click. Yeah, the new set's coming up. Be up in about 30 seconds. Why don't you guys move those old ones off, and we'll just troubleshoot them later. 30 seconds later, company is now playing video. We didn't reboot a server. Why? Can't reboot it as fast as we just fixed the problem. How do you fix it? It's send another set of VMs a config. If you think you have a problem with a server and your first thought is, let me reboot it and troubleshoot it, you're thinking wrong. The answer is, well, first of all, get the company back into the green. Bring another one up. Now, if I want to troubleshoot this to figure out what went wrong, of course that's valuable. They troubleshot what their problem was, and they found that one of their SANs wasn't reporting disk space accurately. And they ran out. Is that important to know? Hell yeah. But not when the company is down. Get it? I do this with everything. Infrastructure from code, Exchange, SQL, websites. I can build a company's entire internal infrastructure over and over and over again. And if I make a change to one of these configs and it does something bad, I have source control. I just revert back to an older config and throw it back out. Not a big deal. Nobody has ever shipped perfect code. Stop trying to manage like it's perfect code. We're going to make breaks. Just be able to roll it back real quick. So, let me show you what the results are. You want to see if it worked? Do you believe I got a couple of web servers and websites?
Yep.
Jeez, you guys are tough. There's the public website.
By the way, I don't see him in here, but it was actually a guy from this user group like 4 or 5 years ago who made that picture to make fun of me, and I've kept it ever since.
Oh my God.
I hate cats, so no, that's not my... Some guy actually said, is that really your website? And I'm like, get out.
Let's see if my secured website worked. Then we're going to destroy one of them. You all know what this is, right? This is actually, if you happen to get a chance to see me do the full presentation of this, this is actually pretty hard to pull off.
So I'm currently managing, you get PowerShell Web Access, yeah? But that's set up at every company I work with, by the way. And also, something I always do, since my web servers are core, they all have IIS remote management set up. So my config has all that capabilities, too, because you can't graphically manage a core box unless you turn on the remote management. If you don't know how to do that with IIS, it's complicated, it sucks, and nobody knows. So I wrote about it so that everybody would know. If you could do it with DSC, so that, you really want to. Anyways, it's not my point.
Hey, you want to do something funny? I know this is small on my screen, but I'm on server S1. That's that one with that public website. You want to remove the web service? Totally obliterate the web thing. Yeah? Well, let's do it. Remove. Window. I can't spell Windows. Feature. web-server. Now, I'm intentionally not going to have him restart here because I'm going to restart him the way that I like to restart him. He's killing the web server. Wave goodbye. No, go like this. Come on. I know it's late at night. I'm going drinking later, so I don't give a whether you wave or not. So the web server's dead. Yeah, just leave it. Now, this may be cached, but let's try it. Yeah, it's still cached. And, of course, I can't get rid of a cache on IE to save my life. I know, it never works for me. Anyways, it's dead. So if I try to get to the regular default website on that guy, start iExplore, HTTP, S1, it's dead. Yeah? Now, when you remove components, you saw the message to restart it. So I'm going to restart it. And I like to restart things with dash wait. That's way when I'm scripting something, I know not to start the next lines of code until it comes back. Because this won't go to the next line of code if you use dash wait until Windows remoting comes back up on that server. So I just kind of like to do it this way. So moral of the story so far is we sent a config out to these boxes, and then some jerk junior admin like me just went up and just blew it all away. Good so far? There was no joke at the end of that. There was just... Well, let's see what happens here. Now, if it's something that you're doing and you're not restarting, what I'm about to show you is going to happen in 15 minutes anyways. And that's the window by default. If somebody screws with it, within 15 minutes, it'll become unscrewed. It's desired state configuration, not required state. Required state would be very complicated. Someday we will have that. It has to go off of all the windows eventing. But right now, the government standards of DOD are get us to desired state for the love of God, and we'll go from there. So you hear about products like Puppet and Chef. That's what they all use. So let's see if it came back.
Ta-da.
So here's the deal. I can send new configs to boxes all day long if I need to make changes. If I don't need to make changes, those boxes are just going to sit there and be what they were told to be. And if somebody walks up and tries to do something to those boxes are going to just be what they're supposed to be. Really makes a case for having good change control and change management just got a lot easier. Because here's the thing. The jerk that walked up to this box to remove that web server, yeah, that got recorded. So now I'm going to go find that guy, and I'm going to say, apparently you don't understand how things work here. You never touch a server, period. It's not how stuff gets done here. Do it again, you get fired. That simple. Matter of fact, why don't you go screw in some servers into a rack somewhere? Here's a screwdriver for your moment. Go. Come on, that was funny. I know it's mean.
Can we do the same thing with desktops?
The answer to that is yes. However, I want to give you a little dose of reality with all of this. The dose of reality is that this is designed right now for servers. And there's a reason for this. Do you guys know what's most important in the world to Microsoft right now?
Azure.
Satya says it all the time.
What?
Azure. Cloud first. This is designed for managing servers at Azure scale, which is the largest scale in the history of the world. Azure doesn't run clients. Yeah. You get containers. By the way, you might want to look that up. Can you manage clients? I have a couple of customers that are working to manage clients. Here's what your challenge is. You need resources, the little number ones. And we have a lot of them. We don't have all of them. And we certainly don't have ones for your custom applications. But here's the cool part. Remember I brought up PowerShell Web Access? That requires that you set authorization rules in order to be able to use that. There is no resource currently written for that. Guess what I did?
Wrote it.
Yeah, it's easy. Because I know, we call this imperative code, but I know how to manage using PowerShell, those authorization rules. So I just wrote that into a resource, and now anybody can use that resource. So the moral of the story to that is, you can fix your own or solve your own problems that other people haven't solved for you already. That's an important part to this. Yes, sir.
I just wanted to say that, yeah, clients are not in scope right now, but PowerShell DSC ships with 13 resources. Those resources include file, zip, registry, services, and things like that. All of those resources will work on a client machine. One of your major problems, if you're, one of the problems I have with my CorpNet laptop is that they go in and they set the screensaver timeout and the energy timeout, on my laptop to like 5 minutes. So I'm working on my other laptop, I turn around, and I've missed a meeting, because my laptop went to sleep and Outlook didn't remind me of the meeting. So I thought, well, I'll write a DSC resource using my registry provider, and I'll go in and I will just set those values, and then I'll set my resource manager to refresh more frequently than CorpNet refreshes our configuration policy. Yeah, and that would have been fine.
By the way, don't do it. He's telling you. This is where you're trying to break the contention you have with group policies, and I'm pretty sure people are going to get upset.
But that would have been fine, and it would have worked perfectly, except that using the registry provider, I can't get access to my current config. So when you're dealing with client and user issues, you're currently logged on user, you've got to be very limited in that. And so Jason's absolutely right. You need to use group policy in order to set those configuration issues. But machine-type things, like services and files and compressed files and archives and all of those kinds of stuff, you can absolutely use DSC to refresh. Now, as a matter of fact, he mentioned that DSC automatically refreshes every 15 minutes. That is a scheduled task. And that scheduled task does exist, is configured, and does run already on your Windows client. So it's there, and it will work for a number of things, just not for everything.
And to add to that, I have a very large customer that they have a lot of custom applications, and they issue those custom applications to their clients and their customers over DSC. But that is outside of the current Microsoft design box. Can you do it? Absolutely. You don't have a lot of support for it, though, right now. Something else I want to give you is another little story. So I'm just showing you here. And after next week, this will be available online. Configuration, have you guys written a function before? It's exactly the same thing, only we changed the word function to configuration. You have parameter sets, just like bleh. Mine's a little bit different than that, but here's how I install a web server. I just tell it, I want a web server. Now, I got anal because I had to tell it every feature of the web server I wanted to be explicit. And then later on, I told it every feature I didn't want some jerk going back and, adding to it because it would break what I'm doing. But you could do this because it's easy. I don't want to say it's easy. I got to stop saying that because nothing's easy when you start it. But here's the thing. It is possible for you to do the entire infrastructure of DSC once with pull server, secure. Never do an unsecured pull server, by the way. Secured pull servers, all this kind of stuff. You do it once and you sit back and you go, you know what? This is actually really simple. And here's why. I'm going to steal a DevOps phrase as Snover says it. Why isn't this more complicated? Why is it so simple? The answer is you can't scale complexity. So what you're going to find is, when you dig into this, configuration is just a MOF file. It's just a MOF file that some agent on Windows is running as a scheduled task. That's simple. I love simple solutions. Sir?
To allow for continuous integration and continuous deployment, mm-hmm. About what degree of MOF do you actually design to? Do you design to the actual physical file and size, or how far do you actually go?
And this is a great question.
Continuous integration.
Yeah, this is a great.
Have to change.
Yeah, this is a great question, and I want to point out this is also a rather advanced question because you should start with things that are very simple, like try to make a web server before you try to make a domain controller that contains a web server that has an application with DNS and DHCP. So I start off with parameterized configurations as simple testing. Then I immediately move to composites with
and I didn't want to show anybody this, but I use configuration data must be separate from code. So I do all nodes, break down each individual node with its own specific property information. That way, all I do is cut, paste, boom, I've got another node if I need a different type. And at this point, I do composite resource so that all of this written out here is actually written into resources, because a SQL guy, a network guy, they're going to want to be able to modify their stuff, and I don't want them all looking at the same configuration file. So it grows day one. As soon as you're past the learning stage with this, it's day one, you got to get it scaled up.
Yeah.
The moth file will always be this tiny little bitty thing that a pull server can send out real fast, but you got to dive into the what I would call the advanced configurations pretty quick if you're using this in the real world outside of a lab.
Yeah.
Guys, I want to give you another quick story. So I forgot what the story was. I told you about the whole outage thing and the whole pets versus cattle thing. Oh, yeah, this is the story I hate. Some of you know me, and I am somebody who, I donate a lot of my time. I'm not a big fan of donating stuff because it doesn't pay the mortgage. You with me? So I don't do things for free. But it turns out I do a lot of things for free. I spend a lot of time with people. PowerShell.org, I don't get paid for that. We do that all free. Matter of fact, I have to say this. I could not survive dealing with PowerShell. We're an official nonprofit now. By the way, nobody in the tech industry is a nonprofit unless they're a religion or a political group. We got it. The IRS went all through my behind on this. And if it wasn't for Teresa Wilson helping us out with the accounting and all that kind of stuff, I never would have survived any of this. We do all this free. So it turns out that I donate a lot of time, even though I damn well don't believe in it. I just do it. So I have to tell you, the next story I'm going to tell you sucks because it hurts me on the inside, but I want you to understand something. I own a calculator. I spend a lot of time talking to leadership teams. I've got two short stories. Let me give you an example. I was at a conference a few months ago, and one of the guys coming out of one of the DSC things go, yeah, that's kind of cool, but I don't need to learn it. And I said, oh, okay. Why is that? Just curious. Oh, that's never going to happen at my company. Oh, okay. What he didn't know was that I met with his leadership team earlier in the week at a dinner. That's exactly what they were going to do. The problem was this. They're not going to do it with him or the rest of their IT team because they don't know how to do it. And here's where the other company comes in. He had 35 Windows IT guys. This company wants to be able to go to continuous delivery, which is more than just configuration management, but they need configuration management, they need source control, they need their IT guys to be developers and get this crap done. They need to be able to rebuild stuff like this, they need to make change like this, not we'll get to it in 6 months. This company couldn't even get a private cloud put in because these guys didn't even know what that was. Oh, it's just virtualization, right? No, it isn't just virtualization. And so anyways, I'm sitting down with them. And one of them, of course, the CFO. You know how many CFOs own calculators? All of them. And they know how to use them. That's the thing that irritates me. Because very quickly, they said, 35 guys got to get trained in PowerShell, automation, and eventually up to DSC. Now, it takes, we've all estimated this, from somebody starting off new, it takes them 3 to 5 years to gain the expertise level to be able to pull this off. So that means they now have to train them, they now have to baby them through 3 to 5 years. Or, we can hire a Linux guy. Now look, I want to teach these guys, I want to help them advance their careers. I am the kind of guy that this is my soul. This is what I do. But I can't argue with numbers. As a consultant, my answer has to be, here's four guys I know. And that's exactly what they did. They're down to four Windows guys. They've got four Linux guys. They now have continuous delivery. There's still problems, but they have infrastructure from code and delivers, and they're on their way. Their company is now competing against their competitors again because the website's getting updated from the developers 4 times a day with new features. Oh, feature's not working. Roll it back. Not a problem. Don't sweat it. Get it? Now, the
That's a sucky note to end on. That just makes you want to cry, right? Let's end on a better one. Everybody in this room, that's not going to happen to. You guys already get it. This is the technology you want to be looking at now. So where are you going to find the resources? I know you all can't just go driving off to a conference or something. Although I got to tell you, it's a great way to do it right now. Because you don't have a lot of book resources, because books don't pay my mortgage. Don Jones and I are talking about writing a complete DSE book for the release of 2016, the server 2016. We've talked about it, so we might. But there are videos out there. There are videos on Pluralsight, but you need to be careful about something. You need to think about what version of PowerShell you want to use. You want to use WMF5. Now, you can do a lot of this with WMF4. I want to recommend to you that you look at WMF5. Well, you know, I don't have server 2012 R2. That's okay. WMF5 is down-level supported. You can install it on a 2008 R2 box. You can install it on a Windows 7 box. Like I've done here, I author everything on Windows 10. I only use Windows 10 to author on. And then things go off to servers. You never author on a server. My servers are all core, but yours don't have to be. But you can do this. Try to see if you can implement with WMF5 that's more feature-rich. Also, that's the thing going forward. I know that it just officially got released and all that kind of stuff, but this is the way we're doing it. The other thing is that I would strongly recommend is that you reach out to the community that's doing this. Now, it's not just as simple as going out to PowerShell.org, although we do have a special forum for DSE. Well, I don't want to put anything there. I don't know what the hell I'm talking about. That's why we have the forum. There are no dumb questions, just dumb people. And if you stay dumb if you don't ask. So that's what it's for. There's also some very advanced stuff in there. Stephen Morosky and I are trying to troubleshoot an architecture problem with the PowerShell team. Okay, but there's also very straightforward stuff. There are, some of you have seen the MBA videos. That's a great place to start because everything we discussed in February still exists that way today. Not as many bugs as we had when we did it in February, but that was supposed to be funny. But reach out to the people that can help you and that want to help you. There aren't that many of us. If you start doing this for real and you start moving into production and you start having problems, here's who you want to be following, reading, and communicating with. And yes, these people will communicate with you. Stephen Morosky is number one. Dave Wyatt is number two. I'm number three. We do this for a living. Also, I want to give you this because you're going to hear this. I don't want to hide things from you. I do everything with the Microsoft tooling except when I can't. Source control I do with Git. There's other tooling that DSC currently does not have that will be important to you, like reporting services and stuff like that, pre-graphs that managers can look at. DSC is a platform for other people to build that tooling on, although I will say that Microsoft, you have to know that Microsoft is building that tooling as well. And it's not called SCCM, thank God. I also want to point out that companies that have no development team, that means you, that means developers that code applications, that means you, that can't write tools. If they don't have somebody that can write tools, they buy a product like Chef or Puppet that use DSC but have their own tooling on front to make it even easier. I have several people that, yeah, we're putting in Chef because we ain't got anybody to deal with this. So you can look at, you should look at those products. The goal is get your DevOps moving. Be the guy, gal doing it, the one that knows it. I don't care if you want to get into this with me or if you want to use Chef, do it. If you do it with DSC, you're going to get a lot of support as well. I usually recommend that for people that have experienced automators that are not afraid to learn how to deal with DSC. Because you guys will know how to build the tools that you need. You guys know how to, well, it's going to give report back some data. I need that in a SQL database so I can run reporting services. Okay, put it in the SQL and run reporting services. Okay, I can make that happen. So if you are confident that you can do that, and that's not the hard part, so I can do that, then stick with DSC. It's free.
Yay.
Poor easy payments. What do you guys think?
It's the wave of the future.
Wave of the future. So, is it worth looking into? Yeah.
Make it so.
Make it so. Now, if you are interested, soup to nuts code, although without the explanation, it isn't really going to help you, but soup to nuts code
will
go over and touch it again.
Yeah,
here, let me.
It.
It's feeling lonely.
Kidding.
Don't worry, that's my normal life. what was I just saying?
Soup
to Nuts Code will be available, and I'll send the link to Tom because I don't know what it's going to be till after Tech Mentor. I have code that I'm going to release after Tech Mentor. Then another set of code that we're going to release after the summit. I'll send Tom the link. He'll be at it, so he'll get the link for it. So you can get that code that will take you from soup to nuts. Secured pull servers. Don't be that guy that does anything else. Secured pull servers, very important. Other than that, questions, comments, bitches, abuses.
Can you speak into here and say to our boss we need to learn DSC?
Oh, not just DSC you need to learn, but DevOps and continuous delivery. If you don't know that, your company's going away anyways. I don't care. And this is not a Microsoft thing. This is what the companies are doing now. This is what DevOps is. Continuous delivery is what's making them agile to get those features out to their customers faster. Whether you use all Microsoft or you go to Chef, which does Linux and all of that, it doesn't matter. You just need to do it. I would like to do it with Microsoft stuff because it does Linux too. And there is nothing cooler than watching the look on a Linux guy's face when you go, I just configured your boxes. Because you know they hate us, right? So, Linux guys? Oh, so you got the beard for it. Nah, but you got a personality. So anyway, guys with beards have no personality. Questions? Yes, just yell it out.
So containers...
I'm not getting into containers, but you need to.
Containers.
I'm not staying in. I'm in. I told you I have a drinking thing I need to go to. Containers, you guys need to get into containers. Containers, developers around the world are writing everything for containers now. Containers, if you bring in Dan Wallin, and he's super developer, it's all he does. Containers. Everything's in a container, and in the world of Linux, it's been done that way for a long time. Containers are revolutionizing how applications get run for the right reasons. You guys have lived with putting an application on a box, installing another application, and those two arguing with each other. One doesn't work. All that crap goes away with containers. And with Server 2016, you better believe that's going to be the number one IT conversation where developers are just going to turn around and go, we assume you have an infrastructure for containers. And the IT guy is going to sit there going, I got a container. You need to start thinking and planning about this now because it's going to become a requirement. This can all also be done with configuration management. But that's as far as I'm going to go in containers because that's a heck of a conversation. Somebody else. I'm sorry. Did I answer your question as far as I was willing to?
I just want to know if I'm guessing it's a yes, but DSC and containers, my guess is they will play well together.
Yeah, it's different technologies, but accomplishing similar business solutions. So containers are more the application side, whether it's a cloud-based app, your private cloud-based app, but the infrastructure underneath to support those containers is going to be configured with DSC.
So you mentioned it's usable with Linux. Is that also something you can do with Linux?
Yes. Yes, we have... you have to have, it's very easy to do on a Linux box, an OMI server that supports the protocol. Then we can directly, by the way, when you set this up, you can actually sign into a Linux box with PowerShell and do crap to it. Because I don't know if you guys know how Linux works, it's only file management. We have all the resources already for it. It's easy to configure a Linux box, a heck of a lot easier than a Windows box. Windows boxes are hard because they're so cool. Linux boxes are easy because they're, but yes, any flavor. And actually, if you actually Google that, you will see setup instructions for the Linux side for SentinelOS, Red Hat, for Ubuntu, for whatever it is you got, we can deal with.
Sweet.
And if you can't find it, send me an email because I know a guy that can. At Microsoft, that's all he lives and breathes that. It's the other really cool thing is look at us configuring switches now. Yeah, so I turned to a friend of mine who's a CCIE, and I said, we just don't need you anymore. He did not like that. Because that was an expensive cert to get. But yeah, you can configure switches now. So, anyways, cool?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.